Hi, welcome to part three of our four-part women's series all about growth. My name is Emily Simons, and I am the women's pastor at the Square Church, and I am so glad that you are joining us for this part three. I'm really excited because we have been going through the verse of Luke 2:52. Jesus grew in wisdom, stature, and in favor with God and with humans. And we decided, let's take a look at each one of those areas of growth, each one of those ways that Jesus grew, and let's dive in and try to do the same. And so today is all about wisdom. You get to hear from nutritional therapy practitioner Meg Langston. And as I was looking at the word wisdom, the Greek word in the New Testament is sophia, and it means both a spiritual knowledge and intelligence as well as a worldly one, just knowing things and being aware of things both in the world and spiritual. And I think that today you are going to be challenged as she brings wisdom and knowledge and just a vast bank of experience to us specifically as women and specifically in this cultural moment. So join me in welcoming Meg Langston.
God made everything and he is in everything. My goal here is to present to you the impact that pursuing health as a body of Christ can make our purpose here on earth more effective. I want to address what health can mean to us and I think should mean to us and how culture and the enemy can twist things. My story shares a good bit about how I chase culture's view of health and wellness and really got stuck in the world's self-focused and painfully exhausting view of health and wellness, which only stole my identity, purpose, and created hormone imbalances, thyroid dysfunctions, and even infertility. So who am I? As Emily said, I'm a nutritional therapy practitioner, certified NCI specialist and NCI mindset coach. I now work with women all over the world to help find the root cause or causes and take a food-first approach, heavily discussing identity, mindset, as we discuss lifestyle and supplements as needed. However, I got into this field based on a personal story and that story was a lot of suffering through an eating disorder and living the dream as a fitness model and sponsored athlete, which I will get into in a second. But I want to say that I can honestly say standing up here that I come from a place of healing and deep love and appreciation for pursuing health, but not in the way that the world would describe it and define it, but the way that Jesus would. So I grew up a competitive soccer athlete from the age of 4 to 18, and I decided to pass on some scholarships and just went to college. And I can remember that I had a specific conversation with my dad, and we were talking about, I said, Dad, you know, I'm starting to put on a little weight. Like, I wasn't really partying or anything at this time. Like, I don't know what's going on. And so he's like, well, Meg, what are you eating? I was like, well, I'm having Special K for breakfast because, like, back in 2007, I don't know if you guys remember, but Special K was, like, it, especially with, like, the little dark chocolate pieces. So I was having Special K for breakfast. I was having, you know, a turkey sandwich, Jimmy John's for lunch, and pasta for dinner. And he's like, Meg, all you're eating is carbs. I'm like, what's a carb? Don't I need carbs? And I was like, you know, not as much as you may think when you were, you know, at soccer tournament after soccer tournament. So anyway, that conversation was really like, and my dad's an amazing person, by the way, but that was the first time that I can really remember hearing the word carb and thinking about, okay, so what goes into my mouth, the food that I'm eating will impact the my body composition. And so back in the older days of 2006 and 2007, when I was in college, you know, Facebook really started becoming a thing, which I feel like this is making me sound old, but Facebook really started becoming a thing. And there wasn't a lot of like resources for how to, you know, you couldn't just Google or look on Instagram or Facebook of like where to get health and nutrition advice. So a lot of what I was looking for was in magazines, Oxygen magazine and Shape Her magazine. And these magazines really praised like a body type. And that body type is what was defined as health. And what's interesting about these body types is like they were skinny, but like not too skinny. They had muscle, but not too much muscle. They were curvy, but like not too curvy. So, I mean, a lot of mixed messages. I mean, even like from hairstyles, like you had long hair, but then also short and sassy. So, I mean, I really honestly tried on all of these descriptions that was defined as health by these magazines and media. And I can honestly say that, like, this is really where this restrictive self-objectification behavior started. And really my eating disorder and purging and just practicing self-hatred came. Was from a definition of what health was defined by culture. So in my early 20s, I moved to San Diego, and around like the first year that I was living there, I was told that I should do bodybuilding, and because I had the perfect figure for it. And if you're unfamiliar with what bodybuilding is, it's basically a sport, and it is a sport that you are judged on based on your aesthetics and your ability to, bring proportioned, this is so silly, but quads to shoulders and things like that. And then the other really big part of the bodybuilding industry is your personality. And it's so funny because when you actually get on stage, you have to wear like heels and you pose and you try to show off your muscles and the hard work that you put into it to have this ideal body image. And I remember this, and this just is a side note to show you my personality. I grew up with three brothers, and in part of bodybuilding, I had to walk in heels, and I have to find the clip, but I could not even walk in heels, and that was like part of the judgment. Super side note, but I think it's really important to understand I can't walk in heels. So anyway, in all of this search of restrictive behavior and trying to understand what health meant and defining it by these body image and this idealistic composition, I was really lost in my purpose and identity. And at this point, I really didn't have a relationship with the Lord. I had heard of who Jesus was when I was younger, but I definitely didn't go to church. We were not brought up talking about Jesus. I just was aware of who he was. And I think that's really important that I didn't have a relationship or my identity wasn't in Christ. So I started getting praise for my body transformation as I was stepping into the bodybuilding industry. I was thinner than I ever had been. I was getting lots of followers on Instagram because Instagram started to finally come up a little bit then. And companies were sponsoring me, sending me clothes to wear, shoes to wear, all to promote their companies. And I felt like, man, I finally made it. Like the world is recognizing me based on my ability to transform my body image. And they're saying to me, like, you're exactly what we want you to be. Like, I finally felt like, okay, world, you wanted me to be this image that was portrayed as health on these magazines and in media. And I'm finally there. And I felt accepted by the world. But inside, I felt like I was never good enough. I would look around me and I would constantly compare myself to others. I would look for men to compliment me and women to share their thoughts on how I inspired them. And that would give me life again for like a short period of time until I would eat something that would totally throw me off of, you know, my restrictive diet plan. And it could be something like a carrot, because at that time I believed, oh my gosh, carrots have so much sugar. And I would practice self-hatred and purging. And then I would wait for an Instagram message or somebody to walk by and give me a compliment to be able to keep me in that restrictive mindset of, okay, world, I'm gonna keep up with what you want me to be. So I recently shared a picture of my malnourished body on my Instagram page because I just think it's important. I'm starting to change my belief a little bit on this, but I thought it would be really important to share this message of, like, this is not what health is. So I shared this picture that I was incredibly malnourished. I think most people in a healthy mindset could say, like, yeah, there's something wrong there. But even then, just to show you where culture is at, even then, I was still getting comments and messages of the world saying, like, you're good. This is what we want you to be. And what's interesting is that during this time, I had completely been suffering from anxiety and not having a period and thyroid issues. I really suffered with, if I didn't stay in this restrictive mindset, what was the world going to think of me? What was my identity going to be? I would then start that mindset circle of this, I'm not good enough. I need to restrict more. I have no self-control. If I'm only going to be loved if, and praised if, admired if, I was able to restrict and maintain this body image. And eventually that lifestyle and that mindset really did catch up with me. I was exploited for pictures ending up somewhere I really didn't want them to, which was devastating to me. I had blood coming up every time I purged. My teeth were in horrible health, and I actually suffered from such severe anxiety that I can remember a time where one of my really good friends said to me, hey, do you want mint or do you want bubble gum? And I had a full-blown panic attack because my anxiety was off the roof, that coming up with a decision of whether I wanted mint or bubble gum. I couldn't make that decision. It threw me off. And it doesn't make sense, right? But when you're unhealthy, things don't make sense. But I was still getting praised. I was still getting opportunities based on my body image despite my actual health. The desires and demand I had on myself to keep up with culture's definition of beauty and health was in every way of the sense rotting my soul, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. So I had spent a lot of time during this process of trying to heal, really questioning the Lord and wanting to know more about Him. Because when you're struggling with your identity and you're hurting physically and emotionally from the inside out, you like innately know that there's peace out there. And I would go to church and I would see all these like really content people, all different body sizes, and that's all that I wanted. And I spent a lot of time just pursuing Christ and really wrestling with my identity and what that was. But oddly enough, at this time when I was starting to attend church, even during this time of trying to heal and wrestle with my identity, church staff would compliment me on my body. And I remember one girl asking if I could do her diet for her, if I could control her diet, and if she could work out with me. And she didn't know I didn't have a period, or that years later I would have developed subclinical hypothyroidism, such severe anxiety that I blew up over a bubble gum. She saw what everybody else did, a fit body that gave me some kind of authority and inspiration to the world's definition of beauty. Sometimes the world's definition of health is so powerful that even us as believers can't see when someone is unhealthy and hurting. And that is some major influence that the world and the enemy has. At my lowest, when my pictures were exploited, I remember feeling so much shame. This was not who I was in any way, shape, or form. This was all the while I was starting to get to know Jesus and fall deeply in love with Him. But Jesus came to meet me where my shame was. As I learned more about Him, I realized that He made us perfect. There was nothing else I had to strive for. And any shame that I felt, He completely forgave. Jesus never talked about body image or looking a certain way when it comes to health. Culture did. So I took some time away from the health and wellness industry and stepped into a job that supported pastors and leadership in the churches. It was there that I just saw how unhealthy the church can be and its people. Coffee was served at all different hours, donuts, sugar, highly processed snacks. Over each gathering that they were together and praying for one another. And we would pray for mental health and clarity and depression and fertility. All the while, these snacks and these foods would be there. I began to see that God is in everything, and that means health. That means that the food that He provides, He is in. I think of God's kindness when I think truly of fruits and vegetables, and I know that sounds crazy, but just hear me out. The very thing that our body runs off of from a cellular, molecular level is literally the fruits and vegetables, and I think animal proteins, we can talk about that another time, that we are able to digest, absorb, and utilize. And that is the Lord's kindness. God providing healing on this earth for our use before we were even existing. And I believe that is our responsibility to gain the healthy relationship and balance and discipline to utilize God's resources well. It was culture that took that gift of pursuing health and the enemy that made it self-focused, self-gaining, completely obsessed with how other people viewed each other and not God's perspective in this idea of health. Taking health and turning away from the Lord is what I saw happening. I look back and I saw how Jesus was my great physician and yours. He always has been. I think about algae. Algae is algae, and it's you may be familiar with spirulina or chlorella. It was here first on the planet before any of us were here. And it helps with cancer. It helps with detoxing. It helps with providing abundance of nutrients like choline, which 90% of us are, especially women, are deficient in. And choline actually supports infants' IQ levels, or carrots, the very thing I was actually absolutely afraid of, will bind to too much estrogen in our body. That can wreak havoc on our thyroid. It can be the cause for cancer. It can impact infertility. And honestly, I could go on and on and on about how these fruits and vegetables and animal proteins can literally bring healing to our body. Then I think about the living word, how Jesus forgave all of my shame and fear of truly not being good enough, or I felt I wasn't good enough for the mistake I had made and the people I led on to believe that I was happy and healthy when I absolutely wasn't. The Holy Spirit met me where I was to fill me with His love, His identity, and address my anxious fears for not being enough, not being anyone if I didn't have the brains and the body image and the athleticism or whatever lies I was telling myself. Jesus, the great physician that healed me physically, emotionally, and spiritually. My heart now is for us as women and a body of believers to be set apart in the way that we safely come to use the Lord's resources in a health and use it for a purpose. Not because health is our identity or even my identity, but because it allows each of us to have an individual purpose, our individual purpose, to propel forward, to grow, when we step in and identify what that looks like. So what health looks like as a believer, I think, means taking it seriously and being responsible with it, and yet not obsessive or allowing it to identify us, to be used to give us what we need in order to live out our unique calling and have boldness and energy to do so. So let's talk about culture versus Jesus. Let's always talk about culture versus Jesus. I think we can all admit that even now with the coronavirus, at some point we've looked on the internet and we've thought, like, you know, do toxins in my detergent actually matter? What do essential oils do? Like, we look at some way, we've looked up in some capacity, or, you know, what nutrient or what foods can I eat to get ready for a vacation? Like, in some way we've gone to the media in order to let the world tell us and the media tell us what health is. Culture influences us using media influences and using constant exposure. Now women from a young age are learning what beautiful is, healthy is, and what is preferred by culture. We are raising the first generation to access the internet more than ever. I mean, we are accessing the internet more than ever. Media has influenced us by women on magazines covers, by promoting how good a 50-year-old body looks through Photoshopped pictures, Instagram influencers, and more. These advertisements, repostings, and sharings on our Instagram stories all send the message that these portrayals are what we should be striving from. From the first morning we wake up, our thought to our evening routine and going to bed, it is completely obsessed with how others think of us and how we define culture by a body image. So let's talk about self-objectification. It's a big word. It's the only word that makes me feel really smart. So when we talk about self-objectification, we're really talking about the objectification theory, which was developed by Fredrickson and Roberts in 1997, if you guys want to look that up. It explains the theoretical framework for exploring media exposure and the consequences it has on body image. It provides an explanation for many mental health risks, which are uniquely experienced by women. Objectification theory specifies that sexual objectification occurs when a woman's body, its parts, or its sexual functions are reduced to being treated as a source of use, a sort of display versus an instrument, meaning we as women are just that. We are an ornament rather than an instrument to accomplish some awesome things. Pollack says, this sociological perspective on self can actually habitual monitoring can increase body shame, anxiety, decrease awareness of the eternal bodily state. So just some fun facts of basically what she's saying is that, and I found this, by the way, in her thesis. This is how, like, into this I am. I looked up her thesis. But an estimated of 33 million women spend over $175 billion on magazines. Can you imagine how influenced we are, or now on Instagram, on the very body image and things that I was talking about earlier? And studies show that if a girl or a woman is in a state of self-objectification, we perform worse on math tests or learning comprehending. If we're reading, we cannot comprehend. If we're in a self-objectification mindset, meaning monitoring our body, thinking about how we're sitting and how our, you know, stomach may be over our jeans, or, you know, our chin or our arms or whatever women think about. When we're in that state, we are literally, we can't even comprehend as much. Not only that, but we actually can't even run as fast, throw the ball as hard, and we cannot lift as heavy weights. We are literally being trapped by this endless mindset of self-objectification and self-hatred that culture has put in front of us with extreme exposure. And I think it's also worth noting and wise to know this, that that eating disorders have increased by 400% since the 1970s. Lindsay Kate, who's actually Pollack's sister, said, if we have just one small negative thought on our body, we are already at a disadvantage. Church, can we imagine the strongholds that we may have on us mentally, physically, and spiritually? When we're in a state of self-objectification, as we're trying to stand strong in our purpose and love others well, self-objectification distracts us from our mission. Culture says we're not enough. Jesus says our sufficiency is from God. Culture says we have to strive for perfection. Jesus says he has stitched us from the inside out in his image, which is absolutely perfect. Culture says that says you are worth nothing more than to wake up, go to work, and figure out how to get that perfect body that because that is what will give you authority, make you worthy, get you success, find you a husband, set you apart, whatever lies you're telling yourself. But Jesus says you are chosen and you are set apart by God. And culture ignores your shame because your shame keeps the enemy living, breathing, and crawling in power. Culture, the enemy, want you to be living in this shame and self-focus on what you are not, so that you lose focus on Jesus and the power that the Lord has for you. Health is important, and pursuing health for our purpose as a body of believers is vastly different than how culture and advertisements want you to view it. To the core, culture wants to make money off of the idealistic image of the 5% body image that is just that, an image of a body. Like, not good, not bad, just an image of a body. Like, what? The question and statement I'm proposing or encouraging is, now that we recognize that is just an image of a body, is how can we pursue health knowing what we know about culture's definition of health? So you may be sitting here and thinking, Meg, body image is not my deal. Self-objectification is not a problem for me. And that's amazing. But I can guarantee you that somebody sitting next to you is having this issue, and or has a daughter, or will have a daughter, or you will know somebody in your life that will suffer from this. I've worked with hundreds of women, again, all over the world. And this is a struggle that they are constantly having and desperately want to come out of. So if this is a message that you're hearing for the first time, it's important to be equipped with this knowledge and language to separate the two perspectives, culture versus Jesus's way, that provides the change that needs to happen so that we can fully be present and renewed in our focus to love others well and to share the gospel clear, focused, and with energy. So as a nutritional therapist, what does wisdom look like in light of Jesus while we still live in the tension of being in the world? So we live in an extreme culture, and I think, like, I'm a really good example of this. The very marathon that I ever signed up was for a full marathon. Like, I've never done a race before, and I was like, I needed to go full marathon. And we live in a culture that is very much like that. And I would say that's honestly my biggest downfall, as well as cultures, is being this extreme culture. However, with health, we don't have to look at it like that, and we shouldn't look at it like that. We need to look at it from the eyes of Jesus. So let's talk about spirit. Jesus is complex, and there are many different parts to him. You may know that in your prayer life. He is not just one answer. Again, you may know that in your prayer life. He is go, and he is rest. He is fun, and he is discipline. He is variety, and he is specific. He is grace, and he is justice. He is quick, and he is patient. Jesus is the healer and the great physician. So are we going to trust Jesus as our healer or culture as our healer? If we're going to pursue health, we should be doing so according to his characteristics, not the world's. So let's talk about physical, when it comes to physical, in light of Jesus. Again, looking this up, let me tell you what the Oxford, according to Oxford, what health is defined by. It says, health is defined by the state of being free from injury and illness. And although this sounds incredible, I don't know if that's an all-inclusive consideration of health. We can agree with that, right? There is more to health than being free of injury and illness. And as a nutritional therapist, I recognize that health is more complex than that. There are stages, and it requires a journey. It is more important to start where you are, wherever you are, and make the appropriate changes to keep a healthy, vibrant self that is sustainable for your lifestyle. So why, as a believer, is it important to care about your health? Have you ever sat in front of anybody and you just kind of zone off because you have brain fog? You can't really recall what they're saying. Or in the afternoon, you're super sleepy, so you just can't quite help love someone the way that you really feel called to. Or you experience hangry? You experience hangry when you know that's not who you are. It's not who you are. But it impacts you. It stops you from your ability to love others in your most optimal state. That is why, in light of Jesus, our health is important. Jesus made science. There's literally nothing scary about science. I encourage you to look at all the science. Then, you know, you may even fall in love with Jesus more. In fact, the thing I love most about science is that I think it shows off his brilliance even more. So you may be eating out often and experience none of the symptoms of like brain fog or hangry. And you may be like, Meg, that is nothing that I deal with. But did you know that when you are eating, when you aren't eating a nutrient-dense food, the foods that the Lord has provided is what I'm saying, that you are actually impacting your health from a genetic component? I'm gonna geek out for a second. Meaning that the way that we steward our health actually turns on specific genes that can cause diseases. And so even though you may not be feeling those symptoms and the immediate effects, it does impact our genes, which then impacts our kids' genes and our kids' genes. So from a genetic component for future generations, what the Lord provided in eating those foods is incredibly important. Discipline in choosing more nutrient-dense foods allows for your offsprings to be vibrant and focused for the mission of Christ. Science also shows how there's a gut-brain connection. This is my favorite. As you know, Brittany talked about mental health. Our gut is a large, 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 large influence over our mental health. Jesus has designed our body so that the very foods that he provides nourishes our body. For example, did you know that blueberries are full of vitamin B6, which actually our neurotransmitters are made from? Or that our gut and brain talk back, via the vagus nerve? Our gut has over 100 million neurotransmitters in it. I love that. IBS and anxiety are linked. Our gut and our brain are linked. And when you have an overabundance of neurotransmitters in your brain, they call that anxiety. When you have an overabundance of neurotransmitters in your gut, they call that IBS. Have you ever noticed when you're super nervous, like you may have to go to the bathroom a lot? That's the connection. Or depression. They've actually found correlations of decreased neurotransmitters in your brain and decreased neurotransmitters in your gut causing constipation. 90% of serotonin, that feel-good hormone, is in our gut. 50% of dopamine is in our gut. Herbs that the Lord has provided, like dandelion tea, milk thistle, help hormones, help healing hormones, and help with fertility. Slippery elm. Ugh, slippery elm is amazing for Crohn's, IBS, all things the Lord has provided. Algae, I already mentioned. Did you know that 80% of our immune system is in our gut? So like these foods that the Lord is providing actually cause nourishment and healing for our body and protect our immune system, 80%, 80 to 85%. The health of our gut is impacted by how much food we eat on a consistent basis, how much nutrient-dense foods we eat on a consistent basis. And the food that I'm talking about, the food that the Lord provides. This matters because when we do have mood swings, are hangry, don't sleep well, our kids don't sleep well, have digestive issues, it can impact our ability to focus well because you're too hungry. Not always responding with love because you're too tired from your lack of quality sleep. And guess what? This is really interesting. A large part of the melatonin is in your gut as well. Always goes back to the gut. But do you see what I'm saying? Health is like a spider web to our daily living and breathing and how well we're able to do that. The Lord knew this and provided for us. And an unhealthy body can impact the way that we love others, love our kids, the way that we lead. When we are just the slightest bit distracted from our health, it can distract the way that we love people. Okay, I'm almost done here. I know this is a lot, guys. Okay, have you ever seen that meme? It's like, chocolate is from trees and trees are from the earth. So chocolate is like a plant or vegetable. I don't know. It's really funny. You should look it up. It's more funny than I described it. But the point is that Jesus is fun. And I don't believe he wants us to be extreme with our pursuit of health, because when I see my clients that are, even myself, become extreme with health, anxiety comes. And we know that the Lord is not where anxiety is, right? So sometimes pursuing health looks like participating in foods that don't directly impact our genetic makeup. I'm saying that. I'm a nutritional therapist. I'm telling you that sometimes participating and eating cake and celebrating and doing things is a part of health, right? It goes back to that extreme culture. Jesus is not extreme. We have to be wise enough to know when to participate and wise enough when to say no. And guess what? You can pray about that. Healing from an eating disorder, I would often pray about that. You can ask God to show you. Jesus also shows us how to rest. I think that when we are learning that, I think that we're learning more now in social distancing that rest is incredibly important. I know Phil and Emily, I think it was last year, talked a lot about Sabbath. There's the rest and digest state in our body where we are able to start healing because Jesus is our great physician. He knows all this. I know that my thyroid is impacted when I don't set a time to rest. So the point is that health is, it's not just about food. It's about laughing. It's about participating. It's about community. It's about going outside, drinking water. And yes, it is about eating nutrient-dense foods. But it is not about a body image. It is not about a body image. Yeah. So I talked a lot about our body being an instrument and how we need to pursue health and wisdom. So I'm just going to give you 10, you know, tools that you can use because that's what I do. And I'm sure people want to hear this too. No matter where you are, you can step into pursuing health in light of Jesus. That isn't about a body image in any way, shape, or form, or how we would display our bodies, but it allows us to live fully in our purpose with energy and boldness. So one, drink water, filtered water if you can. If you drink your body weight divided by two, you're great. Be in community. I know it's a hard time right now to do that, but schedule Zoom calls, Marco Polos, be in community. Community is huge, especially if you're healing. If you're in that endless cycle of self-objectification, tell somebody. That is truly, truly the community of my church and friends that were believers. When I would go to them, I would say, you know, I'm struggling with my body image. And they would just break that cycle and pray for me. Eat nutrient-dense foods. This means more like fruits, vegetables. Again, I believe in animal protein, and we can always talk about that more. Start cooking your food when we're able to invite people over. I think it's funny. It's not funny. I love that the scriptures always talk about they came to the table because community and food bring so much life and healing. Sleep. sleep is important and you should do it. This is actually something that I feel like a lot of adults need to be reminded of is you should have a sleep routine. Right? Like we expect our kids, like we know our kids need a sleep routine. Why we expect that we don't need a sleep routine is beyond me. But we need a sleep routine. Our body needs to be cued to go to sleep. So whatever that looks like. Rest. Find time to Sabbath. Full day or whatever you can do. Get moving in daily, but not over exercise. That's really important. Don't ever exercise, guys. Ladies. Causes stress to the body. Just move. Turn off, shut down, and get rid of anything that pulls you into self-objectification. For me, it's social media. I pretty much only follow accounts that bring me life now. I don't follow anything from exercising or anything that can make me body focused. And actually, if I have anything body image related, it is accounts that bring me life and remind me that health is not a body image. Serve other people. When we are in a state of self-focus and consumed with our own thoughts, serve someone else. Jesus designed that to bring healing to our body. Get organized. Have fun. Schedule sex. A low libido, guys, is I'm from the Midwest, so guys means ladies. A low libido is a sign of there's something bigger going on, and you need to dig deep into what that is. We should not have a low libido as females. So rest, community, eat nutrient-dense food, have fun, come up with a sleep routine that can all help us. And I think there's a wise man named Pastor Phil. We may know him. He said this once in his sermon. I think it was last year. He said, it's about going after the new, the normal, and then the natural. So like, this may sound new to you, or starting to pursue health in the way of Jesus and not a body image may be new, but it will become normal. And then it will become natural. And then just a bonus tip, ladies, because if you know me, you know I cannot stand here and not talk about the menstrual cycle. If you can become body literate. Get to know your menstrual cycle. It is the fifth vital sign. It is a window to our health. It is absolutely powerful and amazing. And I would love to come up here and talk all about the menstrual cycle one day. But get to know your menstrual cycle. So I love you guys so much, and I'm just praying for healing, and I'm praying for just radical change and the ability to pursue health in light of Jesus, and just that we would all bond together and just create this incredible army and power of women, because we are powerful and some places superior, to change the health and wellness industry and be standing apart with energy and boldness for Jesus. So love you guys.
Don't you just love Meg and her passion? It's so clear to me. I love the way that she just drew a hard line and said the way Jesus looks at all of this is so different than the voices that are shouting at us about who we are and what is valuable and what we should be putting all of our effort to. So I know that was a lot of information, and trust me, she has even more information and wisdom that she has available to disperse. You should totally follow her on Instagram, but I would encourage you, pick one of those things at the list that she gave at the end. Just pick one and make those steps to try and something new and move it towards normal so that it becomes natural. You are worth that. Your value, you are worth taking good care of. And I just am so grateful for her words to the women of our community. I want to pray over us. And if you have any questions, if you need further resources, if this, as I was listening to Meg, I was just stirred up for our food pantry, if I'm being honest. And so if you want to get involved in helping us provide nutrient-dense food to the people in our community that need it, we would love to be the army that raises up and not only cares for ourselves, but cares for our neighbors who need it. So email me at emilysimons@thesquare.org. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that each woman is fearfully and wonderfully made. I thank you that you created us from the very beginning in a garden, intended to grow alongside the plants that were going to nourish us. And I thank you that you said, go eat of all of the food that I have created. And I just pray that you would be working miracles in our bodies and in our minds, in our spirits, that we would align ourselves with the truth of who you are and therefore the truth of who we are and what our actual responsibility is and where our true value is, Lord. Would you just speak these things into existence in all of our hearts, in all of our minds? Would we be healed of all the things that plague us? Because you are a great provider, you are our physician, and you love us so much. I ask all these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Know that you are loved.